You know what's the coolest thing ever? Not that we can send spacecraft to distant planets, but that we can get high-res images back. Yeah, awesome sauce. Hello everyone, Amy getting nerdy with you about space today on DNews. Every spacecraft, telescope, probe, or lander we've ever sent into space has to communicate with the Earth to both receive commands and return data. Since 1957, when the Soviet Union launched the first ever satellite, Sputnik, they've all used radio waves. A radio wave has a regular pattern, so data is encoded by either changing the amplitude, more simply the height of the wave, or the frequency, which is how close the peaks are together, a value measured in hertz. If we're changing the amplitude, for example, some peaks can be higher than others, and we can assign values to them so the higher peaks are ones and the lower peaks are zeros. If we're changing the frequency, ones can be waves that are closer together, and zeros, waves that are further apart. These patterns are received by radio dishes and interpreted by mission scientists. The process of encoding data and sending it on radio waves is the same regardless of what the spacecraft is sending home, and that could include voice transmissions, spacecraft data, and pictures. Modern spacecraft have digital cameras on board. The core of the camera is a small device made up of light-sensitive pixels on a sensor. Every pixel has an assigned number to denote its position on the sensor. When a camera takes a picture, each pixel then measures the brightness of its specific part of the scene. The measured brightness is also given a corresponding numeric value. So basically, the image is broken down into numbers, one for brightness and one for the location of the pixel on the sensor. Getting the picture back is then a simple process of sending those numbers back to Earth on radio waves. Radio waves are easy enough to receive with radio dishes, just as long as the spacecraft and the dish can see one another, meaning that there aren't any large bodies like planets and moons blocking the wave's path. Then it's just a matter of the mission scientists translating pixel information into an image. So if we have pictures beaming down from all over the solar system, why don't we have video yet? It comes down to how much information radio waves can carry. The limiting factor in radio communications is the bandwidth, or the frequency of a wave. Higher frequency waves can carry more data, but radio waves can only have so high a frequency, even if they're manipulated to encode data. The shortest radio waves are only 300 gigahertz. The frequency can get higher. The thing is, at that point, it becomes visible light. So to have a communication system that can carry more data, you need optical communications. More data can be held in a laser beam than a radio wave because the laser's frequency is much higher. But there's a trade-off. Radio waves are so big they're easy to receive. Laser beams are narrow and have to be perfectly aimed at a receiver. But NASA's working on it. In 2013, scientists beamed a picture of the Mona Lisa to the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter's LOLA instrument, marking the first optical communications beyond Earth orbit. Closer to home, the OPAL's mission used lasers to beam a video to Earth from the International Space Station. So for now, we can only have videos from space made out of images put together to simulate motion. But soon, we could have live video from Mars, with the light time delay, of course. But this is all about how modern cameras work. Back in the 1960s, there were no digital cameras. Apollo astronauts used film on the moon, then developed it back on Earth. So how did we get live footage of Neil Armstrong landing on the moon? I've got a look at how we saw those historic first steps over on my own channel, Vintage Space. The descent stage wasn't just the landing stage. It also carried a lot of cargo that astronauts would need for their stays on the moon. The descent stage was divided into four sections, each of which could be used for storage. But what about color data? The story of modern images from space gets a little more complicated when we talk about how we know what color things are in space. I've got more detail on what color the planets really are in this episode of DNews right here. So if these are the planet's true colors, why do we sometimes see them looking like a psychedelic vision? Because false color is a thing that scientists love. Across the whole electromagnetic spectrum, the human eye can only see a small section. What pictures from deep space do you guys love? Let us know in the comments below and be sure to check back for a new episode of DNews every day of the week.